Tabs on your tongue. I heard the shepherds, I heard the sheep sleep. Now my only one broken sweethearts, oh, who sleep apart. Most of fine hillside spines who sleep out. Suppose now sure she makes a sound she makes to calm me down. So slowly you're so thin. As I begin rubbing others out, your state worsens on my skin. And gold. Violet's finger to lift 1, 2, 3, 4. To pose now sure she makes the sound she made to calm me down.
Cutting it close.
She makes the sound she made.
I'll just start talking.
I'm tired.
Thank you. not. I think our other ones were getting interference from something, which is causing the lag. Does that work for you? Sorry about that.
Yeah, great.
You want me to take this down?
All right. So the idea is, can I use both? I mean, either?
So no, this one's not sending it.
Oh, okay. But then, might as well take it down.
Yeah. Okay. Now bring it up. Yeah. We're just going to use JC's.
Ladies and gentlemen, please silence your cell phones, but be sure to keep tweeting, Instagramming, Snapchatting, Facebooking with hashtag NAMPC.
Hey, morning, everybody. It is so great to be with the NAMP family here in Austin. It's terrific to have you here. I'm Mara Walker, Chief Operating Officer of Americans for the Arts. Thank you. It is my huge pleasure to welcome you to the 2016 National Arts Marketing Project Conference. And for those of you who know folks who can't be here, we are live streaming this session and all of our plenaries, plus a few breakouts. They can be found on the Americans for the Arts YouTube page. So please tweet, Facebook, and let your friends know that they can find out what's going on through YouTube. Okay, so the truth is, it's the prevailing thought that when you're up here, you're supposed to start with a joke, something to warm up the crowd. The truth is, I'm not quite feeling it. Regardless of who your candidate was through this election period, it's been a hell of a time. It's been a ringer for all of us. And we now know we've got incoming a Republican House, a Republican Senate, and a Republican president-elect. At Americans for the Arts, we are going to work with this new administration to make sure that they understand the power of pro-arts policy. President-elect Trump has an interest in the arts, and we appreciate that. We're going to be working with all of the people he puts in play to make sure that they understand the value and commitment to the arts that will make them reach their goals. So much success over the next few years will fall to you. The truth is, our arts marketers, you give great creative, innovative messages. You communicate how the arts unify us, how they empower us with new ideas. You help build bridges. You share emotions. You drive creative expression. You will not just be growing earned income. When you encourage people to participate in the arts, you'll be finding ways to combat hate, finding ways to employ artists, and creating acceptance of new perspectives. And we really appreciate everything that you do. You bring people on all sides of the aisle together in your theaters, your museums, your parks, your performing arts centers, your museums, and all of the community centers in which you work. You create opportunities for dialogue, for learning, and for trust building. We have an incredible opportunity in front of us to use the arts to heal and to unite us. And I know the entire team at Americans for the Arts, looks forward to working with you in the weeks, the months, and the years ahead. So thank you very much. And if this election has taught us anything, it's taught us that change is constant, right? So each of your organizations and the communities that you serve are constantly changing. You are, this weekend, under the header of Fueling Change, we're going to be discussing how we as arts leaders learn to meet those challenges through responsive, creative, and flexible approaches. Austin's a city that embodies a culture of change. Its rich culture is always growing, it's always shifting. As the positive political center, rather, of the state, Austin's identity has transformed from a small town to a thriving city for music and counterculture, and now an idea hub for technology. The changes that the city of Austin has seen have fueled innovative and unconventional thinking, forward-thinking ideas and solutions, and a willingness to experiment. And I hope you're all gonna see that while you're here over the next few days. And speaking of change, the National Arts Marketing Project team has been hard at work rethinking the artsmarketing.org website that I know a lot of you use. So they're looking at the goal of providing rich and relevant content, inspiring arts marketers like you and all the work you do, and continuing to build and strengthen the NAMP community. So out in the center stage area, Josh is gonna be there over the next couple of days showing the website. And I'm asking if you could go take some time and talk with Josh, take a look at it, give him some feedback. We're gonna be launching this site in early 2017. On your tables are some great promos for the new website that I hope you'll take, and you can get more when you're with Josh. So please take a couple minutes, go meet with him in center stage, take a look at the site, give him your feedback, we'd really appreciate it. So before moving on to the next part of today's program, I wanna thank our amazing supporters. First and foremost, our host for this year's conference, the City of Austin Economic Development's Cultural Arts Division under the leadership of the great Megan Wells and her team. Um, among the many contributions that they've made, they have planned an incredible opening reception for us tonight at Canopy, which is a creative center in East Austin. We're going to see performances from artists like the Yes Ma'am Brass Band, the Chaluda Vinyl Club, Typewriter Rodeo, and the Austin Samba School. We're also going to be able to get into some artist studios and have a great time meeting with the artists here. So our thanks go to Big Medium, Dripping Springs Vodka, and Topo Chico for their generous support of tonight's opening reception. So I hope you all have a great time there. We also would like to recognize our sponsors and scholarship supporters who have helped make this conference possible. So that's MailChimp, Grapeseed Media, Patron Manager, Umble, the Applied Materials Foundation, the City of Austin, again, their Economic Development Department's Cultural Arts Division, the Austin Emerging Leader Arts Group, and the Wyatt Brand. Thank you all so much for your support. There are a number of people who really need our thanks, too. First and foremost, I really want to appreciate the Americans for the Arts Board. Ramona Baker is here. So, Ramona, thank you. We have an incoming board member, Deborah Garcia Grigo, is out there somewhere. We're really excited to be working with her from Santa Fe. And Margie Reese Johnson, who I'm not sure in the room, I hope many of you know her. If you don't, you're going to get a chance to hear from her tomorrow. And if you see her in the hallway, it's her birthday today. So if you could wish her happy birthday, that'd be really great. I also want to thank the Americans for the Arts staff. Laura Kakalewski, where is Laura? Right there, has done a tremendous job with Juliet Ramirez, Ruby Harper, Clay Lord. The whole local arts advancement team has done a terrific job. We have an amazing meetings and events staff. I know you've encountered them already. John, Min, Moshe Day, Mark, Dennis, and Terry have been here. I hope you get a chance to meet the whole team. Our marketing and communications efforts have been stunning for this conference. I really appreciate all the creative work. Our finance team is here. Our membership team is here. Our development team. So please get a chance to interact with them if you can. And then last but not least, the NAMP Conference Advisory Committee, I want to take a moment to appreciate them. They give of their time tirelessly to coming up with progressive and new ideas for the conference. You see new things every year for those of you who come back. They are listed in your on-site program. Please thank them when you see them. And I really appreciate their efforts. Okay, to begin this year's program, it's my pleasure to introduce to you the Mayor Steve Adler, the mayor of Austin. Mayor Adler was elected Austin's 52nd mayor in December of 2014 and looks forward to doing big things to improve the quality of life for everyone in Austin. And I mean everyone. As the mayor of this historic first new 10-1 council, Mayor Adler plans to lead Austin's government to a new level of inclusive civic engagement between residents and their elected officials. I think that's really important and a model for cities across the country. Like many others, Mayor Adler fell in love with Austin. He's made it his home for nearly four decades. He's practiced civil rights law for many years and later founded a successful eminent domain law practice representing landowners. He has served nearly 10 years as the Chief of Staff and General Counsel for Texas State Senator Elliot Shapley, and I think this is important, working primarily on school, finance, equity, and access issues. Mayor Adler has been deeply involved with and chaired many of Austin's civic and nonprofit institutions over the past 20 years. He's proud to be well known for the support of arts and music in Austin. Before he was elected mayor, he served on the steering committee for the Creative Austin Master Plan, the Cultural Master Plan, and now in his elected role, he's made supporting our arts community a public priority so that creative individuals and organizations can continue to thrive and grow here, and we're going to see that over the next couple of days as we get out into the community. This year, he was named Rookie of the Year by his fellow mayoral peers around the country, and this is a distinction marked by his interest and commitment to innovative and creative thinking, so he's with the right group of people. Mayor Adler, thank you so much for joining us today, and please join me in giving Mayor Adler a round of applause.
Well, welcome to Austin, Texas. I am excited every time a big group comes to our town. I am real excited that this group has come to our town. The mission that you have, what you're doing in your cities, is truly existential in Austin, Texas. So it's real important for us as a community that you're here. My job was to come and welcome you. I urge folks that I welcome to make sure that you eat our barbecue and eat some of the food trucks. And I always say to groups, make sure that you listen to some of the music in this city, because Austin is the live music capital of the world. So the welcome, now having been completed, I'm going to take the liberty to actually talk to you substantively about your work and what that means for Austin and where we are. Austin is an economy that is on fire. It is a city that is growing rapidly. Austin is the fastest growing metropolitan area in the country, and we have been for the last 5 years. And when I looked last year, we were growing 30% faster than number two. We are the number one place to start new businesses. We're creating more middle class jobs, middle income jobs, than any other city in the country right now. And it is being fueled by the technology sector in this city. Now, I mention that and I focus on that because I will tell you that that happens in part because of the arts and the creative community in this city. When I got to Austin almost four decades ago, we were the 42nd largest city in the country. And we have gone from being the 42nd largest city to being the 11th largest city in that period of time. A lot of the cities that were around us in the 40th ranking are still there. When I got here at that ranking, we were not the live music capital of the world. We were the friendly city. Our big civic event, when people would come to town and we would celebrate and the community we'd get together, was not Austin City Limits or South by Southwest, the festival on music and film and interactive. It was Aquafest, which were speedboat races on the lake. There are a lot of cities that are still the friendly city, where their chief civic gathering spot is speedboat races on their equivalent of our town lake. But in this period of time, Austin changed. Not only did our skyline change, but we became the live music capital of the world. Our focus, how we see ourselves, how we promote this city, how we market this city, changed. And I think a lot of what Austin is today owes itself to that change in how we see ourselves and how other people see us. Now, I've been involved in arts organizations for a long time. Before I signed up for this mayor gig 2 years ago, I chaired the Ballet Austin in this city. I was on the board that helped raise the money and build the Long Center for Performing Arts in this city. My wife chaired the board of the Contemporary, Austin's Contemporary Art Museum. I mean, I know to my core the importance of art in a community, but it goes well beyond the expression that is art. In the role that I'm in right now, I find that I focus a lot more on the economic development aspects of that. And when other mayors come to visit this city and they look at what's happening in Austin and they say, we want to do that too. How does a city become a tech place? How does the city become a city that is creative and entrepreneurial and innovative? And the question I always ask is, how strong is your arts community? Because the same thing, the same thing that drives innovation and creativity and entrepreneurship as it expresses itself in what's happening in this city in technology is exactly the same thing that drives our arts community, our music community, our visual arts community, our creatives in this city. It is exactly the same thing. When I came here as a law student in 1978, I had no intention of staying in Austin, Texas. I grew up on the East Coast in Washington, D.C. I went to college outside of New York. I came to Austin because it was the cheapest law school in the country and they gave me a scholarship. I could afford it. I stayed in Austin because of the music. I stayed in Austin because of the creatives in this community. That was almost 40 years ago. We compete right now to bring in Google and Facebook and Apple. The reason they come here is because the people that they want to have work in those companies want to live in Austin, Texas because of our music and our arts. We don't thrive as a city in spite of the social agenda that has us supporting and emphasizing arts, and we are so proud of our cultural arts division in the city. We thrive as a city because we make that investment. We live the sheet that is on each of your tables when you talk about what it is that arts can be to a community. So the work that you're doing, especially in a city like Austin, Texas, becomes, as I said when I started, existential. We only survive. We only preserve that spirit and soul that is special about this community to the degree that we have a vibrant and flourishing arts community and a self-perception that that is who we are. You walk, stop people on the street and ask them what it is that makes Austin special. And a disproportionate number of them will play back to you that we're the arts, we're the music, live music capital, that we are a creative city. And that happens in part because of the language that we use. It's having the entire community on a similar message that supports the arts and the artists and the creatives in our community. So I'm excited for you and to be able to hear the guest speaker, Adam Lerner, who's going to speak today in from their contemporary museum in Denver, and he'll have a proper introduction in just a second. But his theme, as I understand it, is going to be talking about finding the courage to do the unconventional way of doing things in arts organizations. You know, it speaks to how we try to do things in Austin, Texas. It's a little bit ironic that art is creative and art shows us how to see the world in new and exciting ways, but yet when we sit down, we all too often market art the same way that we always have. I challenge you, especially in this day and age, to be really strong in this message. To be really diligent in the work that you do. Because beyond being existential to this city, it is existential to this country. Make sure you eat some of the barbecue and eat at the food trucks. And make sure that you walk out onto the street at night. Just walk the streets so that you can hear the music that is coming in from the clubs. Welcome to Austin, Texas.
Thank you for being here. It really is a pleasure to be here. Thank you for having me. Wow, thank you to the mayor. Usually elected officials try to stay really far away from me, so it's awesome that you're willing to be associated with me. And wow, you guys are a much, much cooler and better looking group than the art museum directors group, that's for sure. So I will talk about dying of excellence, or not dying of excellence. And I'd like to start, just to make everyone feel comfortable, with some embarrassing family photos. So it's actually a little bit relevant. I grew up in an immigrant Jewish family in Queens, and my father died in 2000 without ever in his life stepping foot in an art museum. And just to give a little bit of more weirdness to this all, he and my mom had dedicated their lives to square dancing. So I was actually the youngest member of the Brooklyn Squares Square Dance Club at age 9. Yeah, which is where I get my moves from, obviously. So we all have our escape fantasies. We all have those things that we sort of strive for to escape from whatever crazy backgrounds we come from. I mean, for some people, it's money. Like, I want to see myself one day driving a BMW. Or for me, it was culture. So to escape this crazy family that I grew up in, it was about, for me, being cultured. And so that was the engine for why I went on to get my PhD and become a curator. And I, you know, was a curator at the Contemporary Museum in Baltimore, and I was a curator. I went to the Denver Art Museum to become an educator in 2001. And then while working at the Denver Art Museum, a real estate developer who was developing a shopping district, a mixed-use district, of course, in the suburbs of Denver, came out and he came to the art museum to create, he proposed that maybe we have an annex of the art museum in this shopping district. And it's, of course, like a crazy idea. But here's the suburb of Lakewood, Colorado, where he wanted to have some paintings. Well, the director of the Denver Art Museum said, well, maybe, I don't know about an annex, but we brought this crazy guy in from Baltimore, and maybe he can give you some ideas about what you want to do. Well, at the time, this development was a 22-block development, and I was really interested in creating an international art space. I mean, remember, this is like my thing. I was all interested in creating the kind of culture that would give me the status that I was seeking. From an early age, I think. So I created a space that I called The Lab. It was an exploration of art and ideas, and I wanted it to be a sort of relevant international art space, on the one hand. On the other hand, there's this part of me that just, that had a sense of play, that had a strong desire to connect with actually what is a more authentic stretch of culture. So it turns out, the developer had said, like, oh, maybe we'll develop a space, we'll create a nice gallery for you or a building. But before they ended up doing that, I wanted to do some programming in the space. And the first program that I developed was a program that actually combined those very, very sort of elevated aspects of culture, the things you find in university classrooms and, you know, museums, with the sort of everyday aspects of life, some of the things that the mayor talked about. And the program I first developed was called Mixed Taste. Tag team lectures on unrelated topics. It was the idea that we wouldn't have one lecturer come and speak to an audience, you know, as is usual for, you know, educational programming, but rather we would have two lecturers, one speak on one subject for a half an hour, like T.S. Eliot, and the second speaker speak on a completely unrelated subject for a half an hour, and then question and answer on both at the same time. So the first one we did, we were in empty storefronts, unleased spaces. There wasn't even a restaurant in the development at the time. The first one was flower arranging and the Grateful Dead. And there was like 10 people there. This is the second one. There were like 15 people. We thought this is amazing. And then when we had Walt Whitman and Whole Hog Cooking, We had to move to a bigger space because we were actually now at about 40 people. And the next week, we had 80 people. And then the next week after that, we had about 120 people. By the end of the season, we're getting about 150 people. What was happening is that we were starting to even color the whole reputation of this 22-block development because of this creative program. Here's just a sample of that season for you. It was carnivorous plants and color field painting, earth art and goat cheese, capoeira and Le Corbusier. We just name things according to what sounds good together. Chinese opera and Alfred Hitchcock, Walt Whitman and whole hog cooking, tequila and dark energy in the universe. Of course, you're all saying, like, that's the same thing. Soul food and existentialism. Prairie Dogs and Gertrude Stein. That's a good one. Summer blockbuster was Marxism and kittens, kittens, kittens. Of course, if you have a lecture on Marxism, you'll have, like, 8 Grigsley graduate students who show up. You know, if you have a lecture on cats, you'll probably have like 12 cat ladies there. You know, we have a lecture on Marxism and kittens, kittens, kittens. We had 250 people show up, suburbs of Denver. So the sort of success of the program convinced the developer actually to build a new space. We actually had a second floor facility built out. And, you know, we used to advertise that we are, here's the audience that looked like in that space. We used to advertise that we were conveniently located between Zales and Yankee Candle. And so, you know, even while we did this program, we would, you know, when we had the new space, we were able to do international exhibitions. And so we did an exhibition, for example, of Isaac Julian. And I co-curated this, or co-produced it even, with my colleague at the Pompidou Center in Paris. And we used to say, too, like, if you want to go to the world premiere of Isaac Julian's Fantôme Afrique, you have to go to Paris, to the Centre Pompidou. But if you want to see the US premiere, just come to Lakewood, Colorado. And so at this time, I actually was starting to learn a little bit more even about myself. So first thing I learned was that it's important to know when not to do what your funders want you to do. Right? Because remember, this real estate developer came to the art museum and said he wanted to show art. He said that he wanted to, you know, have a gallery space for paintings. That was his concept. And he was an incredibly creative guy. His name was Mark Falcone, and he's still one of my primary sort of people to talk about with to inspire me. But he was not an art innovator. He was in general like open-minded guy. And so if I would have listened to him and said, oh, well, my funder wants me to show art, well, then I would have been a really boring space. But instead, I said, let's do something even more than art. Let's think about why we even have art and try to get at something that approaches that. And the thing about mixed taste that's interesting is, just to go back a little bit here, is it's not art in itself. I mean, when you pair Walt Whitman and whole hog cooking, but it gets at, it makes you see the world with fresh eyes. Like if you think about like where you want to go to dinner when you're in your hometowns, your mind would probably go to the same space, right? You probably always go to the same restaurant. But if I say, think of a restaurant that begins with letter A, and then tomorrow I say, think of a restaurant that begins with letter B, and next day C, well then it forces you to actually think about new things. It forces you to break out of your existing patterns of thought that we naturally go to, and that's what mixed taste does. And that's actually what all art does. All art takes you out of your own world and allows you to enter into another world, which on some level, all art is about breaking out of our existing conventions of seeing the world. And so, mixed taste was not art, but it was the spirit of art. And that's actually, even though my funder didn't know that that's what he wanted, that's actually what he really thought was extraordinary, which is why he was willing to invest so much in us. But again, I was starting to not just learn about art, but I was starting to learn about myself. So even though this is what I started with, because I wanted a logo that was you know, going to be appreciated by people in, you know, Zurich, or and I wanted the sort of status associated with this sort of sans serif, lots of white space sort of credibility, you know. But this other side of me that liked this aspect of play, that sort of felt there's something very human about that, wasn't satisfied. And so I said, like, we're a lab. Let's have as our logo a Labrador Retriever. And so we created this logo, the lab, and then we had a whole series of them. For example, like, the lab is smart. The lab makes friends. And then my favorite, get to know the lab. This is all designed by a fantastic designer, graphic designer, Ellen Bruss Design, EBD Design. And I feel like what she was able to do is in some ways even take my ideas and teach me more about what they could possibly be, as every good designer should do. But, you know, I was still a little bit scared because, you know, I should just tell you that when I started Mixed Taste, I took all of my colleagues from graduate school, I took my advisor from graduate school off the mailing list when I sent out the invitations. I was so afraid that they would think I've gone soft, like, oh my God, like, we thought he was on his way to a good career as an intellectual, and look what he's become. Ridiculous. So, even this, I was like, this is amazing, but I'm a little bit scared. So I put together two focus groups for a little bit of cover on this. And two focus groups, people who've been coming to our programs, they loved it, they loved their exhibitions. Some people who, you know, they came, they never came back, we don't know why. Anyway, in both focus groups, we asked people what they thought of our programming. Everyone said they loved it. We asked people what they thought of this new identity they were thinking about rolling out. They said, do not do this. Do not do this. It's, people will not understand it. They'll think you're a vet. Like, they're like, well, you should have like a beaker or a test tube. You're a lab. So it's terrifying because, you know, this is two separate focus groups. There's 20 people here who all really respected us, and they all said not to do this thing that I was really, like, kind of thought was cool. So I said, screw it. I'm going to do it anyway. And it was amazing because what I learned from that is that you can't ask other people to protect you from your own risk. You can't ask other people to allow you to take a chance. Like, you have to find the courage from within yourself, because they will always protect you, and you have to do it without permission. So it was incredibly successful. People, when they talk about the institution, they started talking about it like, oh, this is a great place out in Lakewood, Colorado. It's in a shopping district, but it's so cool. It's called the lab, but they have a Labrador Retriever as their logo. So it was became like this crucial center of who we were, and people started to reward us for the taking courage. So while we're doing international exhibitions, like this one by Fang Lijun, we also sort of were kind of encouraged by our own sense of self-mockery. To be able to do playful things. Like, so we had a membership program, and we gave away free sacks of rubble to all new members. And we were actually across the street from Dick's Sporting Goods. Here we are. And so we had a sign in our window saying, like, welcome to the lab. We're not Dick's. We had their logo there. And after 6 months or so, like, they complained. And I know. And so we published this apology, which said, the lab sincerely apologizes to our neighbors, Dick's Sporting Goods, for the sign in our window saying we're not Dick's. Apparently, we are. So in 2009, there was a vacancy at the directorship of the Museum of Contemporary Art. And it was a recession time, and it was appropriate, actually, to apply for that role. And so 2009, the lab at Belmar was shuttered, and I became the director of the Museum of Contemporary Art in Denver. And at that point, class clown becomes class president. And we did a lot of things. This is a brand new building designed by David Ajay. and I was the sort of first director for the new building. We did a lot of things to take the lab stuff with us. You know, we even took the lab dog into our logo to say that we're not just a museum, but we're a laboratory. We took mixed taste with us as well. And now we couldn't have enough room in the museum itself, which only fit had an auditorium only that could fit 150 people. So we did an industrial garage across the street where we would sell out pretty much every night at about 330 people a night. We would do it once a week during the summer times. We took other programming that we had developed. We did things like Feminism and Co., which is a spin-off of Mixed Taste, where we would pair in this one on contact sports, where we would pair like a 1960 feminist sort of pioneer of self-defense classes with like young roller girl groups. And programs like Art Fitness Training, where it's a workshop on how to look at art, but it's, I think, innovative because it changes the language for how people talk about, how people communicate with their audiences. At the same time, so we took all these programs that we had sort of incubated at the lab. I sort of think of the lab as a little bit like my five-year kind of research grant in many ways. We all did exhibitions that had this sort of also contemporary risk-taking, innovative feel to it, as you would in the field, like these shoes by Vivienne LeCourtois. She wears them a different, she makes her own shoes out of rope and wears them until they wear out and keeps them, and she only wears these shoes. Or this installation by Spencer Finch. This sculpture by Gonzalo Lebrija, which we had commissioned outside of our building. Or this painting exhibition by Barnaby Furness, a leading artist in the field. But all the time that we're doing these exhibitions, there's a feeling that I had about a lack of the quality that I saw in so much of art, but yet did not see in the gallery. And so what happens is when you look at an exhibition like this, you know, you see the sort of sublime painting, but you don't see the sort of the risk-taking. You don't see the energy of risk and courage that it takes to make art. And we all know that there's something that happens when an artist takes a chance to do something that hasn't been done before, and that's their process, that's their nature. But yet, when it arrives at the museum, when it arrives on the walls, all of a sudden it becomes a beautiful object. All of that insecurity, all of the chaos, all the tension gets sort of buttoned up into a beautiful thing. And I said, you know what, all the time I talk about how we learn from artists. We learn from Andy Warhol that art and life are connected. I say we learn from this artist, but I didn't really learn anything. If I'm going to really learn something from artists, I've got to learn actually how to myself, as a museum director, put some skin in the game, actually take genuine risks. And so I was scared, again, because I was now the director of like a legit organization. I mean, not what my father would call a real museum, but still, like something. And I think that in creating this program, knew that I was on some level pulling my punch. And partly it's because of donors. I could, like, you're all like a friendly group. I could like sort of share with you that, you know, there are a lot of people who are on the board of trustees of the museum who had spent a lot of money to be able to build the building, and they expected this level of elegance and propriety. And there were some people who were genuinely suspicious of the craziness that Lerner is going to bring. And that's not their idea of what a museum should be. It should be this elevated space that then like welcomes everybody. But still, it should be this sort of beautiful, pristine, precious, pure space. And they were thought that, yeah, there's some marketing value in having like a little bit of craziness, but really you want to just, what really matters is the creating these elevated experiences. So I did not want to be the guy who alienated the biggest donors the museum had, who I think were suspicious of some of this programming. But you know, after about a year of pulling my punch, I said, I can't do this anymore. I said this to myself. I said, I can't do this anymore. Like, I'm not my best self in this role. I'm not offering the city what is the best I have to offer. And so I said, I'm going to do what I do. And if they want to fire me, they can fire me. But it's going to be like, I'm going to be who I am. And so the programming started, I stepped up the level of risk that I was willing to take, that I wanted to take. For example, we did a program called Art Meets Beast, which is a 3-day program. There was a bison that had been slaughtered just about 3 weeks before from a local ranch. And then we had an artisan butcher in the gallery. While that was happening, we had a musician playing. He's actually a vegetarian. His name is Roger Green. So we called it the vegetarian option. And then we had sort of 3 days of talks about and discussion and presentations about the relationship between art and food, and there are a lot of those. And then it culminated in a dinner where 300 people, we ate the bison. And while that was happening, we had musicians playing music on animal bones. I feel like this is, again, it's not about, like, is this art? But to me, it felt like it was deeply connected to the spirit of art. It was, we often see art and say, like, oh, that was great, that was excellent. But we rarely will say, like, oh, that is who we are. And I think that connecting food felt to me like a way of taking those traditional aspects of that are shown in cultural institutions and connecting it to the very culture of our everyday life so that we can say that this art that is not just great, but it is an expression of who we are. Because our closest connection to culture is not the, you know, our operas or symphonies or what's in the museums. Our closest connection to culture is probably like the language we speak and the food we eat. And so I wanted to draw that authentic connection. A friend of mine has this saying. He told me that once you know, it's amazing, but museums and I guess all cultural institutions, they are really good at excellence, but they're not so great at awesome. And I thought, like, yeah, that's what we need to be. Like, our baseline is excellence, but we need to care about awesomeness. So we started to add a lot more of gags. Yeah, gags into what it is we do. So when we would do mixed taste programming, for example, we would give away awards. And like, we just have a raffle and we give away something. Like, and so, like, you know, usually, like, you get 2 free drinks in our cafe. We're trying to promote business in the cafe. Remember, I took over in that 2009, the recession, trying to get more revenue. So we thought, okay, instead of like just giving people a voucher when they win, we give people like a cinder block, and they have to like carry this cinder block that says "good for 2 free drinks," you know, up to the cafe. You know, and we do all sorts of crazy things. Like, you know, it would be like another time we give away like this a mascot that had like on his T-shirt like "good for 2 free drinks," and then the mascot would sit with the person like the rest of the program. I know, it was crazy. And then at one point we did this thing where we made a big sign, "good for 2." I know what happened. This is hilarious. I think it's funny. you can decide for yourself. This is going great, but we realized we forgot to tell the cafe, like, what it is. So somebody would show up at the cinder block and say, "good for 2 free drinks. People were like, okay. And then we give them the drinks. And so then we realized, like, when I was like sitting in the cafe watching that happen, I was like, oh, I forgot to tell. But, and then I realized, like, wait, I could do this for any place then. And so we started to just say to people, like, here's a coupon for a half-price meal at Ted's Montana Grill. And just, like, you know, give them this giant thing that said, "good for a half-price meal." And they would just go to Ted's Montana Grill with that thing. And that worked out well. Ted's was kind of thought that was funny. And then we did that with the Denver Art Museum. We said, like, oh, we're going to give away 2 free tickets to the King Tut exhibition at the Denver Art Museum if you just hand in these to used tires. You know, you can get your free admission. And then we had to stop the program after that. But nevertheless, though, there's something about it that was really about like a sense of play and creativity. Just to say something about these gags is that it wasn't just about like icing on the cake, making things more fun to like, or like, you know, spoonful of sugar, whatever metaphor you want to use. To me, the gags were about us as an institution having a voice that says we want people to laugh, and we want to connect to people as human beings, because that's what happens when you're making a joke and people are laughing. Is that they're responding as humans, and they're responding as humans to us as an organization, not just to the artists that we exhibit. Because, you know, all that time that we were showing all those artists who were doing those crazy works, on some level we were hiding behind the artist. Like, oh, the artist is the one who takes the risks so that we don't have to. Which I think is maybe the ultimate sort of like religious, you know, underlying aspect of, you know, our institutions, is that they are the ones who make the sacrifice for us. But I wanted to actually take on that sacrifice myself, which even happened, not even in just the gags, but in everything. So like when I showed an artist who I love, Fred Sandbach, whose work are so small, I don't know if you know it, but if you don't, I hope you get a chance to see it. It's just simply pieces of yarn that are stretched across the room, and because they're so small, their power feels sublime. It feels like it's almost a sacred resonance throughout the entire building, the entire space. But I said, if I just were to show one gallery of this artist's work, well, that would feel like, oh, that's an interesting exhibition. How is I going to really put skin in the game and feel like I was truly taking a risk with this? Is I gave every inch of the museum to it. And there's something about truly dedicating so much to so little that felt almost spiritual in its significance. And it felt to me like that's the way that I could actually show that this matters. But also, I would do exhibitions that were extremely unconventional. So this is a painting, and it's very similar to paintings by Kazimir Malevich. And a guy walked into my office when I was at the lab at Belmar in Lakewood, Colorado. He walked in there, and he said, hey, I got this painting. You want to see it? And I said, sure. Well, this painting looks a lot like this painting by Kazimir Malevich from 1915. And this painting, by the way, sold at auction for $60 million. And I asked this guy who brought this painting into my office, like, oh, so where'd you get your painting from? And he's like, oh, eBay. And he actually had amassed a collection of about 180 of these things that he bought off of eBay. And these paintings, I went to the vault where he kept them all, and they were amazing. I loved these paintings. And actually, I agreed to exhibit them when I was at the lab at Belmar. And then I got the job at the MCA Denver, and I stalled. I stalled because, again, I was terrified of alienating my board members who would think, like, oh, and now you're even showing fake art? Like, this is crazy. This has gone too far. I thought that I would, like, lose my museum director's license or something if I did an exhibition of art that some guy bought off of eBay. And so I stalled for about a year until, again, I realized, like, you know what? I have to do this. This is interesting to me. And so I did this exhibition that one gallery looked like Museum of Modern Art. And then if you continued through this exhibition, you'd see like all the rest of the paintings. Just waiting for the slide to advance here, actually. All right. Okay, so here's the rest of the paintings. And so it was actually one of the most popular, it was the most popular exhibition during my time then as director. And I think that what made it so powerful was that it actually, in the fact that the paintings were not authentic, it made people ask, what is authenticity? Right? You're having this authentic relationship to these amazing paintings, and you don't know if it was painted by the hand of a master, or the hand of a student, or the hand of a forger, or some guy in Russia who just thought that this is a cool painting to paint. And these paintings came from darkness, and because their status is completely unknown, the story was actually that they had arrived in a shipping container that was left at customs, and so the contents were confiscated by customs and auctioned off, which is a crazy nonsense story. And so basically, these paintings were entirely mysterious in their origins, and because of that, they raised questions about what is it that we love when we love looking at great art? What is it that, how is it that the fact of the master even plays into our equation? And so it was incredibly powerful for me, and I think our audience felt that same way too, so much so that when there was we had one of our visitors was connected to a publisher in New York, and the publisher convinced me to write a book about this, we called From Russia with Doubt, that at least one bookstore thought was number one. So, but meanwhile, we're doing exhibitions that were also works by Adrian Genya, who is sort of, I think, Manet of our time, and curated by our very talented curator, Nora Abrams. But at the same time, still, I curate exhibitions. I do one major exhibition every couple of years. And there's one artist that interested me. His name is Mark Mothersbaugh. And you might know him, he's the lead singer of the band Devo. Funny red hats, whip it good. No? Yeah. Anyway, thank you. And so I did an exhibition, an entire retrospective of the work of Mark Mothersbaugh. Here you have these orchestrions, these music making machines that he created out of found organ pipes and bird calls. And I got to say that here's this an artist who I loved and thought was amazing, but yet he had never had a museum exhibition before. His work is it's playful, surreal. It has musical qualities, but also has sort of really powerful visual sort of sense of absurdity to it. And I was completely alone in being interested in this artist as a museum artist. Usually as a curator, you triangulate. You say, oh, this artist has exhibited enough in respectable places that I'm not taking too much of a risk, but hasn't exhibited so much that I'm just copying everybody else. And so that's how you protect yourself. But here I felt completely alone in believing in this artist, and it was even up until the day that the exhibition opened, I had felt incredibly frightened that maybe I was making a huge mistake. And so another lesson that I learned was that we are constantly trying to, I forgot the point I was trying to make here. I'm sorry. So I guess the lesson I would learn from doing the Mark Mothersbaugh exhibition is that you think that you learn lessons. You think that, okay, I learned the lesson way back at the lab that when I'm fearful, don't worry about it. Don't worry about audience. Just do what it is that's your instinct. I thought that that's something that, that's, we talk about all the time, it's a valuable lesson would be the thing that we say. But actually, if a lesson is really valuable, then you will have to learn it over and over again. And I know that is because I, even though I do ridiculous things a lot and willing to put myself and make myself look ridiculous or humiliate myself in front of groups, I actually am really afraid of that. That's probably my biggest fear. Like when I took over the building at the MCA Denver, we had half the building was in debt, and I was terrified that I was going to be the guy who was responsible for getting the bank to take away the building. And it's funny because my fear was not that the building was going to be gone, but I was going to be humiliated for the fact that it was going to be taken away. Fortunately, I paid down all of the debt on the building, I know. But the more important thing was that it was the fear, my biggest fears express themselves in terms of the fear of being ridiculous. And that's actually something that I never, ever get rid of. I just learn how to understand it. And then when I feel that sense of fear, I feel that sense of like, oh, I think I might be humiliated if I do this, then I know that it's an interesting idea. And I do it. And so that's how I felt with the Mark Mothersbaugh exhibition, which we gave the entire building to. And by the time the exhibition opened, this is 30,000 sort of postcard-sized drawings that he created. And I did this exhibition, and it turns out that it ended up being the beginning of a time period where our audience participation increased by 50%. So we had a 50% increase in our visitors. Those people then stayed with us and actually have been increasing ever since. It traveled to 6 museums across the country. The book was listed as number one or in the top 20 by Amazon in arts and photography. It was really, really successful. It was the best thing I ever did. Basically, if you want to judge me on anything, judge me on that, because it's the best thing I ever did. And I was terrified until the day it opened that I was going to be thought of as ridiculous for showing an artist who is not at all even serious, because no one had exhibited him before. And so, to me, I just had to continually relearn the lesson. And by the way, when we opened the exhibition, we had a great opening, but when we closed the exhibition, we stayed up all night. The museum was open all through the night. There I am giving a tour at 2 o'clock in the morning, and we had our exhibition manager, Nick Salisi. He gave a tour at 4 o'clock in the morning, and he just likes wearing bunny suit. So starting to learn from this idea about taking risks, we thought let's take some of the awesomeness that we have in our programming that is for adults, and let's see if we can create that same awesomeness for teens. So we started a program we called the Failure Lab. And the Failure Lab is the idea that you have to risk failure in order to be able to do anything creative. But so much of what high school students face is this pressure to achieve. So we create a space for failure. But we also, they do things like we have drop-in programs where this one Friday night, they work with an artist to make the world's largest sopapilla sculpture. They also have things like, teen music night. Actually 12% of our audience are teens. We even gave out an award. We gave out $20,000 college scholarship to the biggest failure. So basically, high school students who demonstrated willingness to risk failure, we reward them with college scholarships. We also do all sorts of, yeah, isn't that awesome? We also do a range of programming that's not even developed by our programs department. This is actually, it's arranged by this one program we do called Black Sheep Friday. It's organized by our cafe. And so this is air guitar workshops. So we had this guy, Magic Cyclops, a Denver performance artist, come in and do air guitar workshops. And we advertised that we were going to display the world's largest collection of air guitars. So last night, we did a Black Sheep Friday event, folked up karaoke, where we have a live folk band and people can do karaoke live. Another program, 40s, where people can learn swing dancing, but also drink 40-ounce liquor tasting. We have pop art tarts, where people decorate pop tarts with pop art. And then, our annual most well-attended Black Sheep Friday is the Triple Xmas Craft Fair, where people make holiday-inspired erotic embroidery. Um, Okay, like I sometimes am the bartender in a program that we call Nixology, which is bartenders who do not know how to make drinks. There I am with my friends, Adam Gildar, who's our guest bartender, and basically people ask for like, oh, can I have a, you know, Manhattan? And I just give them whatever it is I feel like. Or I don't know anything about bartending. I give them a shot of tequila or something. And I gotta say that, okay, so again, this is not just like, oh, let's do the fun thing to be able to convince people to do the serious thing, which is the art exhibition. This, to me, is how can we as an organization participate in the essence of art, the rule breaking? How can we participate in the creativity, the risk taking? How can we participate in the sense of play that we all find in art? That's the question I ask, because it's nonsense when we say, we learn from this work of art, which we all say at some point. And it's nonsense unless we actually do it, unless we learn from artists to be more like artists ourselves. And that's the one thing that I continually try to do, is to try to convey that sense of energy and spirit that you find in art, in what it means to be an organization. And that also, it connects us to the very vitality of urban life. All of a sudden, art is no longer the separate aspect of our city. The art is actually now a part of the creative energy of what makes cities interesting places. Like some of these programs, like the air guitar workshop, that could happen in a pretty interesting bar in the city. I mean, like you have hotels that actually have really interesting programming. We live in an age of makers. We live in an age of what I call our artistics. People who are not necessarily artists, but they do what they do really artistically. And we want to connect the formal aspects of art and culture with the very vitality of creativity and energy that's about that anybody can participate in. And that's actually it creates a blush on how people see what happens in the gallery if we're willing to do these kinds of creative activities as well. So, I mean, people feel that. This is not a marketing strategy. When they asked me to do this talk, I said, just so you know, I know nothing about marketing. And actually, I'm not a marketing guy. I have no marketing background. And I was like, and they said, that's fine, Adam. Thank you, Laura. But still, so this was not a marketing strategy. This was a strategy about making things more interesting for myself and for everybody else. And people talk about creativity as being out of the box. Like creativity is about like reaching for something that is somehow not in the box you're in, but something that's outside it. That's what people say. But that's never what it feels like to me. Creativity always for me feels like, creativity is asking myself, why is it that that is always done that way? Why is it that this convention is here? And is there a way that's more interesting to me to do it? Creativity is actually about shedding conventions more than it's about reaching for something that's different from yourself. It's actually more about like what's more yourself. And in many ways, all of this comes from my own, I guess, my own inclinations. And on the one hand, I've always had that striving aspect of culture that, you know, that wanted to so much dissociate from that crazy Orthodox Jewish square dance family I grew up in. On the other hand, I wanted to sort of have some of that eccentricity that was probably inherited from that authentic Orthodox Jewish square dance family I came from. Like, that's sort of who I am. And I felt that creating an organization that had some more deeper connection to sort of my nature had this authenticity that had a natural gravitational pull to it. So that's why, like, our programming, like we do feminism and co, we have a lecture program and a program, feminism and co, it's sold out every night this last season. Most of our adult programs sold out, including we do mixed taste. And by the way, so we hired, after we paid down our debt as a museum, we hired a fantastic marketing director, Clayton Kenny, who's actually here, and he's gonna be giving a presentation on a panel at around 1 o'clock today. One of the great suggestions that Clayton had when he first came on board was he said, I think we should kill mixed taste. Like, what? That's my baby. That's like the thing that like the New York Times wrote about me because of mixed taste, you know? Like, you can't kill mixed taste. Like, and actually, that was my reaction, but I thought, that's brilliant. The most creative thing that we could do with mixed taste, a program that sells out almost every night, is to not do it anymore. And the reason is that there's something that's more important than reach, and that is who we are. And we are about newness and risk-taking, and mixed taste is not any longer risk-taking for us. It's safe. It's successful. It brings us money. It brings us audience. And it's not about newness. And we're about newness. And therefore, if we want to really stick to what it is that we care about and we believe in, then we have to give up the things that are very comfortable and familiar to us. And so that's a really important part of moving forward. So this is last year was the last year, we're going to give it over to another organization. You know, it's funny, people say all the time, like, oh, we want to be innovative too, and we want to do mixed taste, we want to do, you know, programming like you. And I say to them, oh yeah, how much do you want to be innovative? Because if you're doing something that's really innovative, and if you're doing something that's really risk-taking, there will be repercussions. How much are you willing to give up? Are you willing to alienate your donors? You have to be. Are you willing to alienate staff? You have to be. Are you willing to, you know, risk criticism from your audience? Are you willing to, in this case, give up, like, money and audience? And you, if it is genuinely new, there will be negative repercussions from doing it, and that's how you know that it's genuinely new. I know this because we're about to do an exhibition that will open in the winter that is, you know, body material that's never been exhibited in a museum before. And we might get sued for it. And, you know, we're doing what we can to be able to, you know, protect ourselves. But the fact is that I know it's risky if the law is involved. And so, again, if it doesn't, you know, you don't feel it, then maybe it's not actually as new. But it's also, it has to pervade the whole culture. You have to, I had to be willing to stand up to my board members and tell them, no, this is what we're doing. And mixed taste and feminism and co and art meets beast, these are not just like the fun things that help people get into exhibitions. This is about understanding our culture from new perspectives. I had to say that. And you know what? I was terrified at first that I would lose donors, and I was especially like the biggest donors we had. And in fact, there were donors that left the museum because it didn't seem like it was the museum that they saw themselves in. But what also happened was many more people, many more donors came to the museum who said, I did not know a museum could be this awesome. And so, like, what I most feared happened, and it wasn't so bad. We even like embrace it all. Like, I was terrified to go to the CEO of a huge company who's our board chair and say to him, like, you know, I'd like us to really expand our feminism program. Culturally, it's a pretty big culture shock, but I did. We created a fundraiser for our feminism program. It's an all men's dinner, which is only meat and no utensils. We also internally nickname it as just give them enough rope. But there's also something about the culture. So there's a culture of the organization as a whole. So for example, like when we have our gala, our gala has this have the spirit of our organization. We don't change in front of our donors from how we are internally, from the amazing staff that we have. So for example, when Mark Mothersbaugh donated this work, photograph of me with red. With green paint on my head, to the auction, we said, okay, so if this sells for a certain amount, then we're gonna pour green slime on Lerner, and then my staff right before the gala, like that day, they're like, what are you going to wear under your tuxedo? So that I'm like, I'm just going to wear a t-shirt. They're like, no. You should wear a leopard print bodysuit. And so that's what I did. So in front of the 500 biggest philanthropists in the city of Denver, I stripped off of my tuxedo and put on it. I was wearing a leopard print bodysuit while I was being slimed. And I'm not naturally that theatrical, but this was fun. And there was something about it too that I felt you feel more awake when you're around the creative energy. That's the kind of when things feel fresh and new, like it gives you that like more oxygen. And that's the thing you want for your visitors. You want them to all to feel. That's what I want them, the staff to feel. I want all, and that's the way I feel when I do something where I take a chance on something that I didn't think I even could do. You know, we have our holiday video where in this last one we brought in a camel as part of it. And again, that's just part of our just speaking to who we are. So even internally on staff, like my assistant Thad, this is him giving me a choice of chicken or beef. I don't know why. But he likes to play gags on me. So at the conference for the art museum directors, the national meeting of art museum. By the way, the art museum directors conference, like everybody wears a suit and tie, like all the men do. It's like super buttoned up kind of place. Not like this at all. But I get an email the day before the conference from the president of the association, and she says, Adam, I see on your registration form that you would like all of your food to be pureed. And I'm just double checking. And I'm like, oh God. I'm very sorry, but that was my assistant, Thad, playing a joke on me. And like, sorry, he's getting me back for something, you know, I'm trying to be all funny and never mind, and no dietary restrictions, ha ha ha, you know, aren't you glad you're inviting me to join the board of trustees of your organization? You know, like trying to be all like, and then, her, by the way, like her only reply was, thanks. Anyway, so, okay, there's something about the gag, which is, you know, again, it's relevant to the spirit of art, because when you creating gags, it's about having the freedom to create the world afresh, to enliven every moment, and not just make that. I mean, he could have filled out the form and written like no dietary restrictions, but by giving it an element of play, he enlivened that moment and made it meaningful, and that's not art, but it's the very essence of art. It's the essence of art is to the freedom to make the world afresh, and I think that that's what we try to have that spirit within, and we try to encourage that. So we did an exhibition of called Energy Effects that actually had these two thermonuclear weapons in them. Well, of course, Nick Salisi, our exhibition manager, decided that he would wear his bunny suit while he was driving the nuclear weapons back to their home. And we actually tried to play a gag on him when he was doing that. Like, so therefore, the staff thought that they would try to call the cops to be able to like oh, it'd be funny if we arrest him because, you know, for carrying nuclear weapons. By the way, the nuclear weapons were not like, they're not loaded. You know, they're decommissioned nuclear weapons. But somebody thought it'd be funny, like, you know, if you got him arrested for carrying nuclear weapons, wearing a bunny suit. But the cops said that they don't, like, do gags. I know, right? So we tried to get a stripper cop, but they need more notice. Like, we're not good at planning. Anyway, our exhibition team, like they really do have a lot of fun, and I think that that's the spirit that we try to convey. Like, for example, when we showed these paintings by Marilyn Minter, these that are based on pornography, our installation team thought it'd be funny to take off their clothes while they're deinstalling them. You know, and I think there's something that we developed. Like, there's a certain trust that we develop with our audience because of the spirit of what it is we do, and we have a relationship. Where people sort of respect us as not taking ourselves seriously, so that we take our subject matter seriously, so that even when we show exhibitions like this very serious exhibition by Adam Pendleton, minimalist conceptual work, Like, we literally had a line out the door for our opening. And Adam Pendleton is not a household name, and yet we have the trust of our audience. And you might notice, too, is like that most of them are sort of younger. Our 70% of our audience, we think, as best we can tell, is between the age of 25 and 44, which is, I think, the opposite for a lot of cultural institutions. And I think that a lot of aspects of what we do are part of that. If we were to just stick to our mission, you know, which is about contemporary art, then we would not have expanded as far as we have been able to reach this audience in a way that is authentic. That actually, if we would have said like, oh, we're about contemporary art only, then we would have gotten it wrong. We would have said like, oh, what's the best contemporary art that we could show, and maybe that will, you know, we can sort of duds it up and create all sorts of like bells and whistles to be able to get people to come in. But instead, by creating a holistic feeling, then we actually are able to develop these relationships with the city around us. People sort of see us as actually occupying a sort of mental space in the city about that stands for newness, creativity, risk-taking as an organization. And therefore, they see themselves differently because of that. And that's really the goal, I'd say, of all, maybe all of us, is to be able to occupy more mental real estate in the minds of the people of your city. And so I think that, like, you know, we have a heart in front of our building, and I really think that maybe that's what we're all meant to do, is that we're all meant to not just sort of take people into our institutions, but actually maybe to be heart centers that send out oxygenated, creative blood into our cities, and then draw the energy of the city into our institutions. You know, so this is our last opening. This is the sort of scene, you know, from the opening, and this video is not playing. But anyway, so the one thing I always tell my staff is, I say it's very important to remember to not be professional, because if you're professional, then you only connect with people as visitors. But if you can know when not to be professional, then you can know when and how to connect with people as human beings. Thanks. What's that? Oh, question. Oh, I thought I was going to escape without questions. Fuck. Okay, questions. No? Good. No. There's got to be some question out there. Come on, I talked for like 50 minutes, and there's like 500 of you. Okay. Hello. Oh, are there microphones? Okay.
Ooh, much better than yelling. Hi.
Hello.
This is my first conference as a nonprofit person.
Maybe we have house lights, maybe?
It's okay. I'm fine. No. My jacket is pink. They can see. My question for you is, this all sounds amazing for Denver. And it sounds amazing in a place that has sort of a vibrant, maybe indie art scene to start with. And I live out in the middle of a cornfield in Illinois. And when I take some of these more, I'm going to call them avant-garde ideas, out to the cornfield in Illinois, there is that backlash that you're talking about, and this dichotomy of what your donors need versus what you'd like to see the future of your city look like. And finding that balance between how can I take a cool idea that worked in Denver and introduce it to the cornfield.
Sure. And I would hope, thank you for the opportunity to answer that, because or address that issue, because I would hope that what people don't get from this talk is good ideas to take back to their organization for programming. I hope that what people get is the lesson about what it feels like to do something that is creative, and creative because it's authentic, and what it feels like to do something that has its own unique voice. And it's going to be different for each of your organizations. It would be the worst thing if you just say, like, oh, Art Meets Beast, we could do that program because, you know, we're based in this area. It makes sense. There is something about who you are. There's something about what your organization's history is. There's something about who your funders are and who your audience is. There's probably less about that than we all think. That I think will determine what is your own version of creativity and authenticity. And I think you have to figure that out for yourself, and you have to do that hard work. I mean, I feel like if it doesn't hurt internally, it's also not going to be legitimate. I mean, it really has to sort of have this its own birthing process that comes from you. You have to birth it yourself. I mean, that's on some level why I started with my family. I mean, if you guys had, like, you know, Jewish square dancing families all, then you would maybe, from Queens, then maybe, you know, you could come up with the same programming. No, I'm just kidding. Is that not funny? I don't know. Anyway, next question. Yes, hello.
Hey, Baltimore.
Hey, Baltimore.
I'm Jean.
Hello.
From Baltimore. Hi.
Thank you.
We miss you.
Oh, I miss Baltimore too. It's great.
One of the things that you talked about is trust. There's not just the trust that you have to build with the audience, but there has to be an internal trust. Obviously, you probably have shed some staff. Some board members,
yeah.
I'd just like to hear more about the trust building inside that it allows
sure.
everybody to go with you.
Yeah, you know, I think everyone, we have an amazing, amazing team. I only mentioned a few names, but everyone on staff is, you know, believes in what we're doing, and they think that they're the coolest amongst their friends, and they, like, and they're proud, and they, and probably the whole, like, the most proud moment in my whole career is probably the night before we opened the Mark Mothers Box exhibition, because I'm the director and I'm slow and I'm like always behind on things. Like we already had a lot of work to do that last night before the opening the next day. And you know what? Everybody on staff from the cafe, you know, they were make sure everybody had food, and to like people in the education department who were just helping put, you know, writing on the walls. And it's because they all believed in what we were doing and were excited by it. I even had some donors, you know, there. And it wasn't easy to build trust, and I had to, there were a lot of also difficult things that I had to do in order to be able to create the staff that I created. And I had to be willing and have the courage to do that. And those were really hard to be able to do. And I feel like I try to make myself as vulnerable to my staff as possible. You know, maybe Clayton and his panel will tell like a different story about like, you know, oh, I got this director, he's a total dick. But I think that actually I feel like we have that trust, because I'm willing to make myself transparent and say like, this hurts, but trust me, I think it's important. And I tell them why, and I think I frequently talk to my staff, just like I show them works of art that inspire me and give me meaning at an all staff meeting. I start most staff meetings with some talk about art. I start every board meeting by just talking about a work of art from history, and I feel like if I share with people like something about why it is we're here, I feel like I'm making myself a little bit more open, and that pays off. And I didn't know it would, but I had a feeling it would, and it does. And it's like I built love amongst my donor base, and I always say if you build love, then money will follow. And I don't really know anything. I'm not even really that great as like methodical fundraiser. I'm not like that organized, but I'm good at building love and inspiring people, and that's what's really worked for us. Same thing with the staff. I really love the staff, and I care about them. And you know, as soon as we had money, the first thing I did was to be able to make sure that everybody on staff was making money, making a salary that was allowed them to afford to live in an expensive city, like increasingly expensive city like Denver. And I think those that is my feelings about the staff is is genuine, like that, and that's why I get the trust. Then you get trust when you put yourself out there.
And last question.
Hello.
Hi. Is this on?
Yeah.
Sorry about that. Ann Stafford, University of Texas, Texas Performing Arts.
Hello.
Welcome to Austin.
Thank you.
Y'all. You obviously have made great inroads into broadening your audience with young people. Mm-hmm. Has that replicated with ethnic and racial diversity?
You know, it's more challenging. I mean, like we've exhibited probably about 30 artists from. We focus on Latin America. We have a very very deep program. We even so close that even two people on our board are from Mexico. We do everything we can, but it's still a challenge for us being in the sort of city center and. Like most of our ethnic diversity really happens through our youth programming, which could be a little bit more targeted. It's a struggle. We all struggle with that as culturals. Good. Well, thank you. Important question. Thank you.
Just give Adam another round of applause. Thanks. I kind of stalked Adam down in Denver, where I live, after I saw the Mark Mothers Bow exhibit and then Cindy Sherman. I'm sorry, not Cindy Sherman, the pretty dirty exhibit. Right. Anyway, he's awesome. Thank you, Adam. We loved having you here. I just want to give a few notes before we all. Part let you know kind of what's happening this morning. Right now you're going to have a 30-minute break, and then you're going to come back in the ballroom and hear the amazing insights from Eric Gensler, president of Capacity Interactive in New York, on their digital benchmark study. So that's what's going to happen next. So before you do that, just a few things. And that is to, if you haven't, download the Americans for the Arts app on your smartphone, because it is a little bit easier sometimes than carrying that big on-site printed program, if you prefer. Just go to your app store, download search for Americans for the Arts, and then once you download that, search National Arts Marketing Project Conference. Ask any of our staff if you need help. Secondly, how many people in this room are members of Americans for the Arts? Well, it's a really good number. Anyway, you should definitely join our coalition and be a part of our community. If you're already a member of Staff of Americans for the Arts, just ask for a member button at our resource table. We would love for you to have one. And if you're interested in joining, stop by the after resource table. We're going to be having a Meet the Members happy hour tomorrow at 5:15 in Center Stage. So please join us. Another thing is that out in Center Stage, you can sign up for dine arounds and one-to-one coaching, as well as innovation challenges. And you might be wondering what those posters are. So those are for this afternoon session, America's Marketers Got Talent game show. So if you were brave enough, sign up to be on a team for one of the innovation challenges, and then meet your team at 4:45 today, and the judges as well. The other thing to note is our opening reception tonight. Boarding buses will begin at 6 o'clock, taking us over to Canopy. And lastly, tomorrow night is our NAMP karaoke, generously sponsored by Wyatt Brand. That's going to be at Mohawk, so make sure that you are there, because it's a can't-miss event. So I think I covered it all. And, oh, yes, on your tables, you should all have a form, and make sure you take it with you, and everyone should have it, right?
Those are the pieces for
Randy's. Yes, oh, for our public opinion poll results, which will be taking place at 12 o'clock today after you have your buffet lunch in Center Stage. Thank you.